the end zone touchdown.
Right through a tunnel of humanity.
The one and dives into the end zone.
LaMichael worked his way and worked his way and got there.
And welcome to the AT&T ESPN All-America team. Some of the best players in all of college football. All of them, they didn't necessarily make this team. But the guys who always make the team here at ESPN, Todd McShay and Robert Smith, they are automatically on this year's team. It's been an interesting year, as usual. Seems we end up back where we started again.
And you know what? Throughout the country, too. The Pac-12, you still have those pro-style quarterbacks with Matt Barkley and Andrew Luck. And the Big 12, we have the gunslingers, guys like Brandon Weeden at Oklahoma State, Landry Jones at Oklahoma. But it's the SEC with all the great defense that's going to win another national championship this year. I find it fascinating. The talent on the defensive side really has become so important in deciding the national title.
Well, I thought what was interesting going into this season was all the tumult going with the conferences changing and the people leaving and going to different conferences. But what has stayed the same, just like you guys are talking about, the Big East and the ACC kind of looked like messes, even though Pitt and Syracuse are supposed to be leaving now, West Virginia leaving in out of the Big East. And then you look at the ACC and what happened this year. We thought Clemson was going to go through undefeated. They beat Virginia Tech on the road, but then lose to Georgia Tech and inexplicably get blown out by NC State. The wheel of fortune in the ACC just spins constantly. It's amazing.
The other thing that never changes from year to year is there's a bunch of guys that weigh about 300 pounds that are after guys like you from the days when you played. The defensive linemen. So why don't we start out right there, and we'll begin with Melvin Ingram of South Carolina. Led South Carolina in sacks with almost 9 and tackles for loss over 13. Gamecocks ranked number 2 in the FBS in pass defense and number 4 in total defense. 2 interceptions this season, 3 total touchdowns, 2 fumble returns for a touchdown, and a 68-yard rushing touchdown on a fake punt.
Well, the guy's a former running back, and as we all know, running backs are the best athletes in all of football. And you watch this guy, he is absolutely fierce when he plays the game, but when he does get the ball in his hands, as you can see right here, such a natural runner. And that's the scary part about a guy his kind of size, when he can move that fast. Very tough for offensive linemen to be able to do anything to stop a guy like that.
Up next is Whitney Mercilus of Illinois. Led FBS in sacks with over 14, forced fumbles with 9, tied for 5th in tackles for loss with almost 20, and the Illini ranked in the top 10 in sacks and tackles for loss.
First of all, Mercilus, what a great name.
Yes.
When you watch him on tape, it's not necessarily that he has elite speed or that explosive burst off the edge. This guy just has the will to get to the quarterback. His motor never stops running, and when he gets there, he hits like a truck. That's why he forces so many fumbles. You saw there the statistic John just read, 9 forced fumble, leads the FBS. He came out of nowhere. Talk about a player that really emerged and came into his own.
And then Devin Still of Penn State, Big Ten Defensive Player of the Year, led them into tackles for loss with 17. Nittany Lions ranking number 5 in the FBS in scoring and pass defense. Finalists for the Bednarik Award and the Nagurski Trophy as a top defensive player.
Boy, just a lot of fun to watch him. Not nearly as explosive as a Melvin Ingram. Doesn't have that kind of speed, but just very disruptive. And you can see him here on the little twist stunt, just finds a way to get there. He's one of those guys that just has a nose for the football, understands angles, tackles very well when he does get there. And at 6'5", 305 pounds, got the long arms to keep offensive linemen away from him.
So again, here's a look at the big guys up front on the defensive line. Melvin Ingram, Whitney Mercilus, and Devin Still, South Carolina, Illinois, and Penn State. And Todd, it seems that just about every team has a 325-pounder who can run a 4.5 40.
Right.
What makes these guys different?
Well, the impact they make. And I think the initial burst and then just the will to get through blocks is what you see consistently with the great ones. Now, there's one other player who would have made that list had we had 4 defensive linemen. We only had 3 this year. Andre Branch from Clemson. He's another one. Like Mercilus, not the elite top-end speed, but constantly motor running, revving all over the field, making plays. This is a fun group to watch.
Yeah, they really are. And I'll tell you, you know, some guys are big. Some guys are fast. Some guys combine those elements and add that element, I think, of ferocity, the motivation that they bring to the game, play in and play out. I think that's what really separates these kind of guys. They understand the techniques that they need to employ to beat offensive linemen, but they just got something a little bit different. There's a switch that goes on when these guys go on the field. It makes them completely different and almost unblockable at times.
You do get past those defensive linemen, and then you have to face the linebackers and the defensive backs. So stick around as we continue with the AT&T All-America team. When we come back, we will look at the guys in the secondary and the linebacking core.
AT&T ESPN All-America Team Show on ABC. Brought to you by AT&T. Get it faster with 4G. We think possible.
This new AT&T 4G LTE is fast.
Hey, two tickets just opened up on the 50.
Yep, about to go pick them up from Will Call.
So 46 seconds ago.
Did you guys hear that Chapman rolled his ankle?
It's done. Get out there.
So 12 seconds ago.
Do you guys know how to post videos to Facebook?
Do you guys know how to post videos to Facebook?
Did you guys hear someone stole
the other team's mascot?
So 27 seconds ago.
Stay a step ahead with 4G LTE, with speeds up to 10 times faster than 3G. AT&T.
I'm burning out this useless telephone.
Hair is gone.
Keep cologne.
Motorhome.
The Rocket Man.
Rocket Man.
Burning out his fuse up here alone.
Burning out his fuse up here alone.
Crystal clear Fender premium audio, one of many premium features available on the all-new Volkswagen Passat, the 2012 Motor Trend Car of the Year.
Wonderful week of the year, Capital One Bowl Week, December 17th through January 2nd on the ESPN networks and ABC. College football lives here.
Welcome back. We've already unveiled the defensive line and our All-America team, and now it's time to look at the linebackers, the guys you don't want to meet if you get past the defensive line. Let's begin with Lavonte David, star of the Nebraska defense, leading the squad in a slew of categories. He was tops in tackles, tackles for a loss, interceptions, forced fumbles, and fumbles recovered. One of the biggest moments came in the Ohio State game, forcing and then recovering a Braxton Miller fumble, which sparked Nebraska's school record comeback.
He's only 6'1", about 225 pounds, may have to move to safety in the NFL. But he flat out flies all over the football field. I love watching David play. So instinctive, reads blocks, gets there before any other defender in the Nebraska team. And when he hits you like he's 245, not 225. David is a big-time playmaker. And I think he, whether it's safety or linebacker at the next level, he's going to make a huge impact.
Continuing, the Georgia defense really didn't receive a lot of fanfare, but was one of the toughest units in the country. And among all the other SEC stars, Jarvis Jones was the one who led the conference in sacks and tackles for a loss, finishing just a half a sack behind our own David Pollock for the school's single-season record.
One word on Jarvis Jones, relentless. So much fun to watch this guy play. Great with his hands. He's good at getting into blockers and then throwing them away. You see so many times he's able to do that. You can see the speed right there, though, to run around guys. 6'3", 241 pounds. He just flat out gets after people. So much fun to watch these guys play. All these defensive players just play at an elevated level that really makes them jump off of the film.
No player came even close to the amount of tackling that Luke Kuechly did this season. Kuechly finishing with 191 tackles on the season. No one else even had more than 147. He also picked off three passes in the season, took one of them back to the house for a touchdown.
He's not that fast. He's not a great athlete, but he is the most instinctive linebacker I think I've ever seen. I mean, go back to Sean Lee, maybe coming out of Penn State in that same category. it's rare to see a player diagnose a play as quickly as Kuechly does. And you've seen Sean Lee make the transition to Dallas. He's one of the star linebackers in the NFL. I think it's going to be the same deal for Kuechly. I saw him live against Florida State on that Thursday night game. I swear he finished with 100 tackles. I mean, every single play Florida State had, he was in on it, whether it was picking off the pass, making the tackle in the backfield, or tracking him down from behind.
Little question, one of the best in the ACC and the entire country. One of the stingiest defenses in the tied in sacks, tackles for a loss, quarterback hurries and forced fumbles. The Tide defense swept all the statistical categories, number one in pass, rush, total, and scoring defense.
Very versatile player as well. At 265 pounds, only 6'1". They play him at that jack position, and it's kind of like an outside linebacker position. Sometimes he has his hand in the dirt. Sometimes he's standing up and dropping back into pass coverage. When you look at the stats for Alabama, it's a little bit necessarily a lot of sacks, but they put pressure on quarterbacks. Courtney Upshaw is a great example of that. 11 quarterback hurries on the season.
So there's your linebackers, Lavonte David, Jarvis Jones, Luke Kuechly, and Courtney Upshaw. And a lot of times these guys come to colleges not necessarily recruited at that position. Maybe a running back, sometimes a tight end who's growing up as well. Is that why they're such great athletes?
I think that's part of it. And sometimes we see the defensive linemen who kind of move back to outside linebacker. Upshaw is an example of that. Jarvis Jones is another one, defensive end who played at USC, had the neck injury, transferred to Georgia, and has made a huge impact. So sometimes the best 3-4 outside linebackers are those undersized defensive ends.
Yeah, no question about it. These guys are the running back of the defense, the true athletes on the defensive side of the ball. They've got great versatility. As Todd talked about, not only the ability sometimes, like a Courtney Upshaw, to have his hand in the dirt or sometimes to be standing up, but you have to think about what these guys have to do from play to play. Sometimes it's a running back blocking them. Sometimes they have to take on a guard or a tackle that's releasing up to the second level, try and shed one of those guys and still make a play. Sometimes it's taking on an ISO with a 280-pound fullback like J.C. Copeland there at LSU. So these guys are very good athletes. They drop back into space. They come up and fill holes. Great athletes on that side of the ball.
And this is as good as an inside linebacker group as I've ever seen. Guys like Manti Te'o from Notre Dame didn't make the list. Dante Hightower from Alabama couldn't make the list. There's just only so many spots on this team. But both Te'o and Hightower are great players that deserve to be mentioned, at least in this category.
Vontaze Burfict, too.
Yep.
Do you get the feeling we're going to hear about how great running backs are throughout this show?
It is a trend that's becoming a little nauseous.
We haven't even got to running backs yet, and we've heard how great they are throughout the show. Now, of course, college football is pass happy. They like to spread it wide and go deep. Therefore, you better have some great defensive backs, and we have some great ones as well. First up, interception machine David Amerson of NC State. He picked off 11 passes this season, not only a school record, but it tied the ACC single-season record set by Dre Bly. Get this, he tallied more interceptions on the year than 51 teams.
And just a sophomore. I mean, it's remarkable. This guy's so instinctive for a young player, just knows where the ball is. His Twitter hashtag, you ready for this, John? Pickoff artist.
Yeah, that works.
Hashtag pickoff artist. All right. Another cocky corner. We'll take it. 6'3", 195 pounds. And what jumps out at me, not just the ball skills, how smooth of an athlete he is.
All right. Another guy will be playing in the national championship game. Mark Barron making the team. Barron has had an outstanding career for Alabama. He's their career leader in tackles, passes, defended, and interceptions. Made 36 starts at safety for the Tide and will have one more to make the BCS National Championship game.
Well, I've loved watching Mark Barron play in that Alabama secondary. And one thing you always know out of an Alabama defense is that the secondary players are going to be physical. They have to come up and make plays. The defensive line's not always trying to make sacks. Those guys aren't always making tackle. A lot of times you have two gap techniques, so you do get some leakage into the secondary. But at the linebacker level and at the secondary level, with guys like Mark Barron coming up and making hits, they're always allowed to still put up good defensive numbers.
Let's keep it in the national championship game, and no surprise, this guy's on the team. He's been unbelievable. Morris Claiborne joining the other defensive backs, picking off 6 passes this season, most on his team, second most in the SEC, returned one of those for a touchdown in LSU's win against Georgia in the SEC championship game.
Safety Tyrann Mathieu gets all the attention, really, and justifiably for all the big plays. But Morris Claiborne is so important to this LSU defense for John Chavis, the defensive coordinator, because what he does is he locks down your best receiver, and he can do it against any opponent. He's 6'2", he has the ability at about 195 pounds to get physical, and as you see there, one of the few corners in the country that knows how to play the ball in the air. He is a flat-out big-time playmaker, almost as good as Patrick Peterson as a cover corner coming out a year ago. And remember, he was a top-five pick for the Arizona Cardinals.
Did you mention Tyrann Mathieu?
I did.
I think you
did. I jumped the gun, sorry.
He's also going to be in New York as a Heisman finalist, the Honey Badger, first defensive back invited to the Heisman ceremony since Charles Woodson won it in 97. And Mathieu scored 4 touchdowns of his own this year, 2 on fumble returns and 2 on punt returns.
Newsflash, America, Tyrann Mathieu is a great football player. Not a very big guy, and if you have not seen the video of the real Honey Badger online and the way that it attacks and goes and gets what it wants, you have got to check that out, because that is exactly the way Tyrann Mathieu plays this game. And forget about how ferocious he is, how much he attacks the ball. The guy is just a good player. He's an instinctive player. He knows where to be on the field and is always making plays.
Defensive backfield, David Everson, Mark Barron, Morris Claiborne, and Tyrann Mathieu. And no surprise that 3 of those guys will be playing in the national championship game.
No, and what's interesting, too, as great as Dre Kirkpatrick is the corner for Alabama and Mark Barron, if you combine the stats of the duos, if you will, Barron and Kirkpatrick, and then Claiborne and Mathieu, the LSU duo in the secondary has 22 more tackles, 6 more interceptions, 6 more forced fumbles, and 4 more returns for touchdowns. It's remarkable, this duo of Mathieu and Claiborne, how great they are at forcing big plays. And that's one big key, I think, when you start to look ahead at this national championship.
And I think when you look at Morris Claiborne, a former wide receiver, Tyrann Mathieu, such a great athlete, probably could have played running back. But, I mean, you've got the guys in the SEC that in a lot of conferences would be playing offense, that are on the defensive side of the ball. And I think that they transform these guys into animals. They're just absolute beasts. And they play with such attitude when they approach the games. They are always out there making plays. And when the ball gets there, you see a guy like Morris Claiborne, he can go up and make those kind of plays. We've seen Tyrann Mathieu do it again and again. You look at this LSU secondary, even Eric Reed, who's a guy that you don't necessarily hear about, he's the one that made the big play against Michael Williams in the Alabama game. Just incredible athletes in the SEC on the defensive side of the ball.
That's now 3 references to running backs, and the challenge is on for him to make a reference in every segment, right, including the next one, which is going to be tough, because when we come back, we're going to unveil who our Coach of the Year is.
Everyone have their new BlackBerry from AT&T? It's 4G, so you can do more faster. So, Catherine, post more YouTube videos of your baby acting adorable.
Baby, on it.
Matt, ignore me and keep updating your fantasy team.
Huh?
Jeff, play a game.
Turbo boosting now, sir.
Dennis, check in everywhere you go on Foursquare.
That's Mayor Dennis of the water cooler.
You're the best. Liz, rock out to Pandora.
Oh, no, I'm an only child.
Well, Nick, you shouldn't even be here. You can do everything from the golf course. Good? Good.
On AT&T, BlackBerry Torch moves at the speed of 4G.
I'm going to grab some more munchies. Be back in a sec. Cool.
What's up, Clay Matthews? You want a piece of me?
This ain't over, punk! Whoa, I see you met my Clay Matthews fathead.
Real big fathead. Get yours at fathead.com.
A vengeful curse trapped them in our world.
They don't remember who they are.
For the first time, one of them will try to break it.
I remember.
ABC's Once Upon a Time. All new Sunday at 8, 7 Central.
Welcome back once again as we are here for bowl season, and it all culminates with the BCS, the Rose Bowl, Wisconsin and Oregon. Wisconsin in for the 2nd consecutive year, Oregon in for the 2nd time in 3 years in that traditional Big Ten, Pac-10 matchup. The Fiesta Bowl promises to be a shootout. Oklahoma State, one of the best offenses in the country. We talked about Blackman and Whedon. And, of course, for Stanford, Andrew Luck, who may walk off with a Heisman Trophy Award. That one should be a great matchup. The Sugar Bowl in New Orleans, Michigan. What a job Brady Hoke has done with that team to get to 10 wins in a BCS Bowl in his first year, and they will go against a Virginia Tech, the at-large, out of the ACC. The Orange Bowl, West Virginia, champions in the Big East against the ACC champions of Clemson. For West Virginia, of course, their last year before they move on to the Big 12, and what a turnaround year for the Clemson Tigers, very close to an undefeated year. And of course, the BCS National Championship game, it's an all-SEC matchup. Alabama facing LSU for the second time. It was a 9-6 field goal game in game number one in overtime. Alabama, with some mistakes in overtime, got backed up, could not kick that field goal in overtime. But many people think both offenses have come a long way since then.
It wasn't a shootout. But
no.
Quarterback play, to me, is interesting, because which team is going to get better quarterback play this time around? You would think it's going to be LSU, because they've got a new starter going into the game in Jordan Jefferson, who's come in. They've spread things out. They're running more option, brings a little bit more athleticism to the position, but has made some big mistakes in key moments in the past. So can he limit those mistakes, and can they do a good job of running the football and creating that option game? On the flip side, A.J. McCarron, from the tape I've watched, Robert, missed a lot of potential throws in that first game round. He's got to play better if Alabama is going to avenge that first loss.
And really, the big pass in that ball game where Eric Reed took it away from Michael Williams, that one even was from Marquise Mays.
Yeah.
That one wasn't even from A.J. McCarron. But I'm taking a look at these defenses. You talk about that quarterback play, and I think Alabama really struggled when Jordan Jefferson came into that first game and started running the option. And I think that Nick Saban's going to be able to go to the drawing board and try and come up with a way to stop that, because it seemed that against conventional runs and against the pass of LSU, they did a pretty good job that day. And when you go on the flip side, you look at this LSU defense, not real big along the defensive line. Sam Montgomery at ends, not very big. Brockers in the middle, and Benny Logan, more of a normal size. Kendrick Adams, a little bit more undersized, also on that defensive line. And they had a little bit of problem, I think, slowing down Trent Richardson in this Alabama running attack. And I think it's going to be interesting to see, because they were bend but don't break the first time around. Are they going to be able to continue that trend in the national championship?
Last year, everybody expected a lot of offense when it was Auburn and Oregon. It was a defensive-minded game. So maybe this time around, everybody suspects defense will get
awfully surprised. Huh?
Game, all right. Not surprisingly, our coach of the year will be coaching in the national championship game. He is Les Miles. His team is dominant this year against one of the toughest schedules. They had eight wins against ranked teams. They didn't go undefeated against Cupcakes. In those games, they left no doubt, winning by an average of 22 points. And should they win the national championship game, and this actually seems hard to do, they will have beaten four teams ranked in the top three in the country.
It's remarkable. And you look at what they've done on the road, too, away from Baton Rouge. And that, to me, really shows a coaching staff that prepares its team to go on the road and play tough games. And they've shown up in each and every single game this year. Les Miles, you know, we make fun of him, the hat and all those things. He's kind of a quirky guy. But you know what? He's hired a great staff. He's surrounded himself with the right people. And he has done a phenomenal job of recruiting. And when you look at it, it all comes down to the players on the field. I think Miles is one of the best recruiters in college football, and that's why he's here with an opportunity to play in the national championship and win one.
And let's talk about that staff a little bit. Steve Kragthorpe, brought in as the offensive coordinator that season, announces that he has Parkinson's and then steps down to the quarterback coach. Greg Studwara becomes the offensive coordinator. So already some mix-up on that staff, and I think it speaks to what Les Miles was able to do with this team this season. You add to that the fact that before the season even started, his starting quarterback, Jordan Jefferson, gets suspended. So you had a lot of controversy swirling around this team, and they were able to weather all of those storms even before the season began. Phenomenal job by Les Miles and his staff.
I will tell you one thing for certain, that LSU will be prepared to play in the national championship game.
Have a great day.
All right. Have a great guy. There were some other coaches. Our already mentioned Brady Hoke at Michigan, who took a team that won 7-6 and took them to a BCS bowl. Lane Kiffin, off the radar for a while, 10-2. He might have been in a BCS bowl if they were eligible. Phil Snyder just comes back once again and keeps on winning. And Kevin Sumlin of Houston, who went to 12-1 and was very close to an undefeated season.
And I'm impressed with Kiffin and how he's been able to keep that team together considering all the things they've gone through, the NCAA sanctions. They've recruited very well. So Pac-10 teams, Pac-12 teams now, watch out because this team is going to be able to play in a bowl game moving forward, and they've recruited so well the last couple of years. I think they're going to have a legitimate chance of being in a BCS bowl next year.
And a little bit off radar, guys. Butch Jones at Cincinnati. I mean, if they don't lose Zach Kolaris at quarterback, what a turnaround it would have been for them. And then Hugh Freeze at Arkansas State in his first year as head coach and his last year at head coach, because he's moving on to Mississippi, did a fantastic job with that team, led them to a 10-2 record.
There's a little question that there were some big surprises throughout the country. I still think Brady Hoke, for me, is the coach of the year for what he got done there with basically the same players, and he's got good recruiting class coming in as well. Stick around. When we come back, the guys who protect the running backs, the offensive line, and we'll also take a look at the guys who will give you field position and put extra points on the board, the special teams, when we return in a moment with our AT&T All-America special.
This new AT&T 4G LTE is fast.
Did you hear Sam got promoted to director?
About 12 seconds ago.
We should get him a present.
Thanks for the gift basket.
You're welcome.
Did you see HR just sent out new
office rules? Because you're currently in violation of 6 of them.
Oh, yeah, baby.
And 7.
You guys hear that Fred's leaving?
So 30 seconds ago.
We'll miss you.
Oh, face cake.
Some leftover cake.
The new HTC Vivid. Stay a step ahead with AT&T 4G LTE with speeds up to 10 times faster than 3G.
How much did you pay for your new car?
What if you could find out what everyone else paid for the car you want before you bought a new car? Well, now you can. Introducing TrueCar.com, the hassle-free, haggle-free, totally free new way to get a guaranteed low price on a new car. Log on to TrueCar.com. Choose the car you want. First, TrueCar.com shows you what others actually paid for the car you're looking for. Then TrueCar.com finds you an even better available price. In minutes, you'll have a TrueCar price protection certificate that you can print out. Take it to a TrueCar certified dealer near you where you can pick up your new car.
I saved $8,300 on TrueCar.com. TrueCar.com was free.
And we saved a heck of a lot of money.
Took 3 clicks and I knew exactly what I was going to pay for the car that I wanted to buy.
The research is done for you by TrueCar.com.
So log on to the hassle-free, haggle-free, totally free way to buy a new car. That's TrueCar.com.
It hurts now, but what a future for Kevin Durant and the Thunder.
A bitter finish to a year that was really championship or failure. The Dallas Mavericks are NBA champions.
Are you paying more and more for cable and enjoying it less and less? Upgrade to Verizon Fios and get TV, internet, and phone for our best price online. Just $79.99 a month for 2 years with a 2-year agreement. This holiday deal is only for a limited time, so don't wait. Get Fios at this great price. Act now and we'll add a special bonus, $300 back. Hurry, go to Verizon.com/greatdeal. Fios, a network ahead.
Catch a glimpse behind the scenes of Boston Ballet's The Nutcracker.
For me, putting up The Nutcracker, it's like mobilizing the whole army. One of my goals when I did the production was to make sure that the dancing is so hard that even when some of the dancers dance it for the 40th time, that it's freshly baked. There's comedy, there's drama, there's fun, there's excitement. It's also for the whole family.
See this version for the last time, presented by State Street Corporation.
One person, a world of difference. Chronicle Monday.
You're watching ESPN on ABC.
All year long, we've asked you to vote, so here are your finalists for the AT&T Player of the Year. Andrew Luck, quarterback at Stanford. Second consecutive trip to New York for the Heisman Finals. And, of course, he came back to play another year, and it was a terrific one for Stanford. RG3, Robert Griffin III, quarterback from Baylor, first player in Baylor history to be invited to the Heisman Finals, and he said after the last game, Baylor may have just won its first Heisman Trophy. Tyrann Mathieu, everyone knows about the Honey Badger, third defensive player finalist since 1993 in the Heisman, and Ndamukong Suh in 2009, and Charles Woodson, who won it in 1997. Monty Ball, just one of the best running backs in the country. 38 total touchdowns this season, one shy of Barry Sanders' FBS record, and he has another game to play in the Rose Bowl as well. And, of course, Trent Richardson, another Heisman finalist, second Alabama running back finalist in 3 years. Mark Ingram won it in 2009. Text vote to 55862, and the winner will be announced at the All-State BCS National Championship game, the AT&T Player of the Year. Time now to move on to the big uglies, as Keith Jackson used to call them, the offensive line. Levy Adcock, that's right, Levy, not Levi like the jeans. He paved the way for most of the potent offenses this year. The Pokes are the top three in the country in pass offense, scoring offense, and total offense. Levy has now been first-team Big 12 in back-to-back seasons.
What I love about him is he's versatile. 6'6", 322 pounds. He can play left tackle, spend most of his time at right tackle, but can flip-flop. You know, the NFL scouts love that about him. And he can line up and absolutely win the battle in the phone booth, which for a lot of spread teams, they don't have that kind of offensive lineman. But Adcock does a great job in pass protection, also helps open those run lanes, which became a big part of Oklahoma State's offensive attack.
Early in the season, a lot of people said there were question marks about LSU's quarterback situation, but not for the guys who were blocking for them. Will Blackwell, who played both right and left guard for the Tigers all season, is on the All-America team. The LSU offensive line allowed just 14 sacks in 13 games this season, fewest in the SEC.
And a really good athlete. You know, you watch this guy on film, he gets up to the second level very well, and you can see that versatility in the numbers, starting five games at right guard and eight games at left guard. But he is also very powerful. We can see him just kind of bulldoze a guy out of his way there, but dropping back into pass coverage or into a pass protection right there, working well in a combination block. Just a very good athlete and understands the game extremely well. All of those offensive linemen do that well.
The guy who helped protect Andrew Luck this season, David DeCastro, helped the Cardinal run for at least 120 yards in every game this year, including an incredible 446 in a huge win against Washington. Those 446 yards shattered the school record for rushing in a game.
I think DeCastro is the best interior offensive lineman in all of college football. You don't see many juniors leave school early for the NFL draft. You don't see many guards get drafted in the first round. Well, DeCastro is going to be a junior that leaves school early and gets drafted in the first round. He does it all. There's really not a negative in his game. Big, powerful, strong run blocker. Did a great job blocking inside in terms of pass protection for Andrew Luck. He's so valuable to this Cardinal offense that, remember, the offensive line was breaking in three new starters this year.
Barrett Jones, of course, part of the group that blocked for Heisman finalist Trent Richardson at Alabama. And get this, his father Rex played basketball at Alabama in the 1980s, but probably most important to Barrett, he was honored with this year's Werfel Trophy, given to the player that best combines exemplary community service with academic and athletic achievements.
And what about him in the classroom? 4.0 GPA.
You're kind of guy,
Robert. Body to go with it, I'll tell you. Brains and brawn. You can see him here playing right tackle, mostly at that left tackle position, getting better with the movement of his feet. Had been a bit of an issue for him. You can see him doing a nice job getting those feet shuffling right there, but also has done a great job in his personal life, the two trips to Haiti. Just an all-around great guy, but he needs to get a little bit meaner for the NFL.
How about this for Georgia? 14 different players recorded a rushing attempt this season, but they had consistency in the form of center Ben Jones on the offensive line. What a career with the Dogs. 48 career starts on the offensive line, ranks him third in school history. He started all 13 games this season.
And 21 straight games he started for Georgia. This guy has been a rock in the middle of this offensive line. I'll be honest. early in the year against Boise State, this group did not do a very good job. And it was Ben Jones that grabbed them all and brought them in and talked to them after the first game and said, we've got to be more physical, we've got to know our assignments, and we've got to get the job done if we're going to make anything of this season. That's exactly what Georgia did, winning nine games down the stretch, so improved. And I know Robert has to talk about running backs here, but how important was he for the young running back Isaiah Crowell as a freshman?
So the big uglies are Adcock, Blackwell, DeCastro, Jones, and Jones. And so here's your chance, Robert. Who are they blocking for?
You never talk over the offensive lineman as a running back. You know that. They're where the bread is buttered offensively. These guys are always a special, fun group, too, because they've got their own clique in the locker rooms. They communicate very well, and they have to communicate very well. It's the most important thing on game day for offensive linemen to agree on what they're seeing from a defensive structure. Because if they don't agree on what it is that they see over there, they can't block it the right way. That's why these guys are also known for their intelligence. I'm laying it on thick for the offensive line.
Yes,
these are the guys that get it done.
That was going to be my point. You made about 9 points there, but the intelligence of these offensive line, you've got to be able to communicate in order to get in the right position and to make sure everyone's blocked, whether it's the run game, pass protection, all of these guys intelligent and know where they need to be in terms of its assignments on every single down.
How many times did you take your guys out for dinner?
Every time we had 100-yard games, anytime they asked, you name it. You got to do it for
those guys. Wouldn't mind working behind this group, though.
Question about it.
Fine.
All right, you got to have great field position. There's no question about that if you're going to win football games. So special teams, although some of the guys in the locker room send these guys off to the side, special teams a very important part of the game. So we begin to comparing kickers to each other is a very tough thing. But we will pick Caleb Sturgis from Florida. He was perfect on point afters this year, 21 for 25 in field goal attempts, and he hit 350 yarders this season and was perfect on the road.
You know, some coaches don't give kickers a lot of respect. Just refer to them as kicker. Don't even refer to them by their first name. Caleb Sturgis isn't one of those guys. As you can see, perfect on the extra points. Very good kicking the ball. And I'll tell you, they don't get enough attention when they're doing things right. They get all the attention when they're doing things wrong. Ask Boise State, Oregon, and Florida State to name a few from this year.
All right, Alabama as well. The All-American punter is Sean Powell from Florida State, who was tops among all punters in the country in punting average, booting them 47 yards on average. And always important for the punter, 63% of his punts weren't even returned. 43% of them were down inside the 20-yard line.
Talk about a big-time leg. You see that 69-yard punt against Oklahoma, the ability to just drive the ball down the field, and then the hang time, which we don't measure, but does such a great job of getting elevation on the kick and allowing his kick cover teams to get down the field. Florida State's got a great kicking team, both in field goals and in the punt game.
Now, for kick returns, Joe Adams may have won this award on the basis of one run that was unbelievable around three-quarters of the way through the season. He led the country with 16.2 yards per return. His biggest moment came against Tennessee when he made the highlight shows across the country with a 60-yard return for a touchdown.
That run against Tennessee, all of our lives are a little bit better because Joe Adams did this against Tennessee. This was unbelievable. For people that haven't seen footage of Barry Sanders, go take a look at Barry Sanders do stuff like this. But this is the modern-day Barry Sanders. Joe Adams, one of the most exciting returns I have ever seen in my life. And I'll tell you, just a great player. Also very productive in the receiver or as a receiver on the offensive side of the ball as well. Certainly deserves that spot on the team.
Caleb Sturgis is your kicker, Sean Powell your punter, and Joe Adams, of course, the return man with that tremendous return against Tennessee. We'll continue with the AT&T ESPN All-America Team Show as we look at the skill players, the showmen, the guys who get to dance in the end zone.
Road trip, buddy. Let's put some music on.
Welcome to Learning Spanish in the Car.
You gotta be kidding me. This is good.
Vámonos.
Vámonos.
Gracias.
Gracias.
Gracias. 13 horas en el carro sin parar y no traes música. Mira, entra y cómprame unas papitas.
Get up to 795 miles per tank in the all-new Passat TDI Clean Diesel, the 2012 Motor Trend Car of the Year.
I'm gonna grab some more munchies. Be back in a sec. Cool.
What's up, Clay Matthews? You want a piece of me?
This ain't over, punk!
Whoa, I see you met my Clay Matthews fathead.
Real big fathead. Get yours at fathead.com.
ABC Tuesday, a special hour of Last Man Standing, is a comedy feast.
Remember that deer I bagged on the opening day of hunting season?
You mean the one you hit with your truck?
Sloppy doughs.
He's giving his daughter the gift.
Dad referred to me as his associate, like I was a lawyer or even an attorney.
Of a fulfilling career.
I'm a little burnt out.
You were there 3 hours.
Or maybe not. ABC's Last Man Standing. All new Tuesday at 8, 7 Central. Part of ABC's Home for the Holidays.
We're close.
There's a reason why the most entertaining guys in all of football at any level seem to be the guys who go up and catch the ball. It's because they think they're the best thing on the field, and many, many times they are. Justin Blackman can make that argument. 2 years in a row, he's won the Biletnikoff Award as the best receiver in all of college football. So good, the records he breaks are his own. 113 catches this year, his own school record. He caught a touchdown in 10 straight games this year, longest streak in the country.
There's no question about it. He's a fantastic athlete, a great receiver, catches the ball extremely well. But I love the attitude with which he approaches the game. He blocks well. He takes big hits. Pops right back up. He reminds me of Hines Ward that way. Got a little bit loose with ball security, as we saw a couple times this year, but just a phenomenal athlete that loves to play the game.
And Brandon Weeden obviously made him his main target, but it seems that because of his height, you put anything near this guy and he's going to come down with it.
Yeah, and I think body control is his greatest strength, and that you're exactly right. He's able to adjust to the football no matter where it's thrown, whether it's going up in the air, climbing the ladder, or breaking off his route, coming back. So helpful for a quarterback when you can be a little bit off target and your receiver can go make a play. I think Blackman, that's really the strength of his game.
All right, let's move on to the next one. Let's move to USC for that. And Robert Woods, who had a tremendous season this year, setting a Pac-12 record for catches, grabbing 111 that broke the record of our own Keyshawn Johnson, another All-American Trojan wideout back in 1995. He doesn't want to be reminded of that. Woods also has a pair of 200-yard receiving games in his career, tying the most in school history. He's only a sophomore.
Good to be Matt Barkley these last couple of years, because when you have a target like Robert Woods, who is always where you expect him to be, I think that's the big thing with Woods. He's not the fastest, he's not the tallest, but he runs crisp routes. He has a great sense of zone coverage, when to stop, when to keep flowing and trying to get a window for his quarterback. And he just does a great job of tracking the ball over his shoulder. Such an impact player for a guy who has average to good measurables, but is not the 6'5", 4'4", speed type of receiver.
And I think, once again, it comes down to attitude for a lot of these guys. You know, are they going to be the type, when that ball's up in the air, they're going to get it? You don't see that from all the players, but you see it from all the great ones. And all of the great ones aren't scared to go across the middle, are never scared to go and make those big plays. And Todd's right. Not exceptional, really, in any athletic department, but I think that will really takes him over the top.
And if you're looking for motivation, Matt Barkley, to come back to college football, Woods and Marquise Lee, the freshman speedster, big-time playmakers on the perimeter.
Plus, the sanctions are off, so they have a chance to play for a national championship at USC next year. Seems the trend in the National Football League is to go to your big tight end. Well, why not do it in college? What a year Clemson had, and Dwayne Allen was a big reason he gets the nod at tight end. Part of Clemson's team that not only won the conference, but was its top passing offense this year. He had a crucial performance against Virginia Tech in the ACC Championship game with two touchdown catches, and both of them were go-ahead scores at the time.
It almost seems like your eyes are deceiving you when you watch certain tight ends play the game, and I think Dwayne Allen is one of those players. You can see that great athletic catch right there. This is the kind of guy that lines up on the end of the line of scrimmage, looks like a tackle for all intents and purposes, but then he can run like that and catch the ball the way that he can. The guy can block, too. I think that's what's really impressive about him, is that he's a complete package as a tight end.
Yeah, you definitely want your tight end to be able to do a lot of different things. With Justin Blackman, who's going to go on to a great career, Robert Woods coming back next year, and Dwayne Allen comes into tight end. When you look at that list, there's so many great receivers in college football. Who would be left off?
Well, one player that would have been on this list had he stayed healthy, I believe, is Ryan Broyles out of Oklahoma. And we give the wide receivers a lot of grief because they talk and they chirp all the time. But they're important. And you see with Ryan Broyles, when he left and was not playing anymore because of the season-ending injury, Landry Jones, his quarterback, fell apart. Zero touchdown passes, three interceptions. They couldn't win a game down the stretch. I think we saw the importance there when Broyles left the lineup for the Sooners.
Yeah, no question about it. You know, Michael Floyd from Notre Dame had a great year. Sammy Watkins, the true freshman at Clemson, a fantastic year as well. And let's not forget about Marvin McNutt from Iowa, another good receiver playing in the Big Ten. So a lot of great athletes all around the country. I guarantee you, Sammy Watkins stays healthy next year, Heisman Trophy in New York. For sure.
I had an NFL scout tell me that if he was eligible for the draft right now, Sammy Watkins, take him in the first round. That's freshman, insane. You never hear that.
Amazing. And you mentioned McNutt. He was not only the go-to guy, he was very often the only guy that they could go to try and win a football game as well. When we come back, the toughest ones to pick, the quarterbacks and Robert Smith's very own favorite category, the running backs, when we return.
This new AT&T 4G LTE is fast.
Hey, two tickets just opened up on the 50.
Yep, about to go pick them up from Will Call.
So 46 seconds ago.
Did you guys hear that Chapman rolled his ankle? It's done. Get out there.
So 12 seconds ago.
Do you guys know how to post videos to Facebook?
Do you guys know how to post videos to Facebook?
Did you guys hear someone stole
the other team's mascot?
So 27 seconds ago.
Stay a step ahead with 4G LTE with speeds up to 10 times faster than 3G. AT&T.
Do you believe in other lives?
All new Sunday. A vengeful curse trapped them in our world.
They don't remember who they are.
For the first time, one of them will try to break it.
Not from Storybridge.
From where then?
But exposing the truth will cost one of them their life.
Your revenge is almost complete.
Nominated for a People's Choice Award. ABC's Once Upon a Time. All new Sunday at 8, 7 Central.
This is what I had to do to get a job. Okay, my eyes are up here.
Man, I feel like a woman.
You played football in college?
Oh! Hey, Shakira, tone down the booty shake a little, will ya?
This is just what my body does, bro.
Hello?
Hey, sweetie, we're gonna get some lunch. Wanna join us?
Who's that woman?
I'll be right there.
Who's that woman?
ABC's Working.
Excuse me. Oh, my God.
Help me.
Series premiere Tuesday, January 3rd, 8:30, 7:30 Central on ABC.
AT&T ESPN All-America Team Show on ABC. Brought to you by AT&T. Get it faster with 4G. We think possible.
Welcome back. Without question, it is certainly difficult to break down an All-American team with all of the great players around the country. But I think, without question, the toughest positions have to be a running back and quarterback. You only get to pick a couple, and you only get to pick one. So let's start with our first running back, and we go to Wisconsin's Monty Ball. 38 rushing touchdowns on the season, but he scored more offensive touchdowns than 45 FBS teams, including Florida, Ohio State, and defending champion Auburn. Ball has scored 228 points this year. No other player has more than 156. He's got a date upcoming in Pasadena with Oregon and another outstanding runner in LaMichael James.
Knew Monty Ball was a great running back, but was a little bit concerned about how much weight he lost and whether or not he would still be a physical presence on this Wisconsin team this year. 230 pounds last year, about 207 this year. But as you can see, very physical, but much better in his lateral movement. Still the great vision, but could really make people miss a lot more than he did. And I think it's also his performance in big games this year. Four touchdowns against Nebraska, four touchdowns against Penn State, and three touchdowns in the championship game against Michigan State.
And this is an offensive line, remember, that lost some studs to the NFL from a year ago, and they're still able to establish the run and do it with power up front. Monty Ball does a great job of reading his blocks and can make that one cut and go. I think that's what makes him so special, is his lateral agility for a physical back.
Was that power? Was that a joke? Was that an inside joke with power up front, running power?
Gotcha.
Yeah. We all feel it. No, no. Monty also has another guy in the backfield with him on our All-American team who's a Heisman Trophy finalist, Trent Richardson. Topped the 100 mark in 9 games this year. That tied a school record set by Mark Ingram, who won the Heisman for Alabama, their first in 2009. Richardson might have saved his best for last, 200 yards against rival Auburn in his last chance to impress the voters.
You know, and I remember when Mark Ingram was the star and Trent Richardson was just his backup, thinking, boy, it's going to be hard to be better than Mark Ingram. This guy did it. I mean, Trent Richardson put it all together and became, I think, one of the most complete backs I've ever evaluated from college to the NFL and ever had the pleasure of watching at the college level. He is such a powerful inside runner, but then he makes the cut and the lateral move, and he's able to catch the football. I think that's the area in the passing game this year, Robert, that he really improved, showing that he can block and he can catch.
Yeah, he really can. Made some big plays against LSU in the past game, 80 yards receiving in that game. And I'll tell you, he runs with such an incredibly fierce attitude. It's so much fun to watch. He's like a more powerful version of Adrian Peterson, without the high-end speed probably, but this guy, he makes defenders pay for even thinking about tackling him. And you can almost sense the distress in the defenders when they try and tackle this guy. Somebody please come help me tackle him.
All right, when you're going to pick a quarterback, I think if you were to ask each of the three of us, it might be difficult to come out with who exactly is the quarterback, with a consensus. So how are you going to do it from out all of the voters among the country? Well, they managed to come up with Andrew Luck. Many, many people feel that he will be the preseason, or probably the number one draft pick in the NFL, All-American this year. And though not all his numbers are up from last year, he's thrown for more yards per game and more touchdowns this year. In his team's biggest win of the year, Luck threw for more than 300 yards and 3 touchdowns in Stanford's showdown against USC in national television as well.
But you look at his career, too. It's not just this year, although we're voting off of this year, but what he's been able to do. You know, he has a touchdown-to-interception ratio of 4-1. This guy is been there from the beginning. You know, you talk about the last 3 years, 38 starts. You see that great catch. But what impresses me most is the win-loss ratio. He won 84% of his games and 92% of his games the last 2 seasons. This is Stanford. I mean, Stanford was abysmal. Stanford was a terrible football team before Andrew Luck, and he turned everything around. So to me, what he's been able to do, the culture of Stanford and the wins and losses is what separates him from everyone else in this department.
And as a pure quarterback, I think the thing that impresses me most is his understanding of defenses, but I think also understanding what type of throw he needs to make. Clearly, he can see when he needs to get a ball with just enough loft to get it over a linebacker and with just enough velocity to get there before a safety arrives. He understands not only the capabilities of his receivers, but the limitations of defenders. And whenever he spots the opportunity, he completes it. I think that's the important part. And you see that, you don't even see that on Sundays. We don't see that with our man Tim Tebow, obviously. But with a lot of quarterbacks around the league, and especially in college football, if there's an open guy, they're not always getting hit. With Andrew Luck, almost always he's hitting that guy. The incompletions are extremely difficult throws or a drop or some other problem that happens. It's almost never because he's inaccurate.
And when you look, once Chris Owusu, his speed receiver from this year, his number one guy went down, he had no one on the perimeter. So people look at the numbers, they look at a couple of the losses, but you have to keep, put it in perspective.
Yeah.
And compare to a guy like Matt Barkley, not taking anything away from Barkley, but when you have great receivers on the perimeter, he got all this done with a bunch of tight ends and a bunch of slow receivers on the outside.
He also seems to have a short memory. If he makes a mistake, it is gone and he's forgotten about it. Now, you could have called this the year of the quarterback because we had some great ones. You mentioned Matt Barkley. USC went 10-2 this year. Big question about whether or not he'll be back. Robert Griffin III will be in New York for the Heisman Trophy. Case Keenum broke every career passing record there is. And Brandon Whedon, he's only 112 years old, but his team was so close to a spot in the national championship.
Man, how old does that make us?
He's only 28 years old, but does he have a chance to play in the national? Is he the next Chris Wenke? And yeah. Wenke was 2 years younger.
Right, and if he's 28 years old, going to be a 29-year-old rookie. If it wasn't for that age, he might be a second-round draft pick. So he's probably going to be third, fourth-round pick, but he has a chance because there are teams that need guys who can throw the ball, and the ball just explodes off of his hand.
And I'll tell you, it's interesting to watch college football and the evolution of the game and offenses and how they've opened up and just how that produces so many big numbers. But it makes it so much fun to watch, especially a guy like Robert Griffin III, such an incredible, versatile athlete. But all of these guys, such great seasons. This has just been so much fun to watch this year.
Now, you mentioned some of those great names, and want to remind everybody to tune in tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern time for the Heisman Trophy presentation. Chris Fowler will let you know who's going to walk up with it. Here are the finalists. Monty Ball of Wisconsin. You see his numbers along with Robert Griffin III, first ever out of Baylor. Andrew Luck, of Stanford. Tyrann Mathieu of LSU, defensive player, and Trent Richardson of Alabama. Here's a look at a blind resume, and we want you to compare these numbers. 9-3 record. You see the passing yardage there, and touchdown interceptions, very close. Rushing yards, not bad, and rushing touchdowns. And who they are? Tim Tebow, the year he won it, he was 9-3. So can Robert Griffin III, who I will admit right here, was number one on my ballot, can he walk off with the trophy?
I'll admit right here, too, John, he was number one on my ballot. I think he should, and I think he will win because of what he did in key moments. And remember, Baylor never, ever beaten Oklahoma before this year.
I don't know. The key moments, 6 interceptions this year, 4 of them coming in his 3 losses. That's the reason I had him at 3, but I had Trent Richardson at 1. Robert Griffin III certainly has a chance.
A little question, though. All the guys that are there are well-deserving. They're going to have a great time while they're in New York. We want to thank you very much for watching, and want to thank all the ESPN.com voters for helping us pick this AT&T All-America team. Don't forget, again, tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN, the Heisman Trophy presentation, and enjoy the bowl season right on up to the BCS National Championship on ESPN.
It's the granddaddy of them all. Monty Ball leads the Big Ten champs into Pasadena to take on LaMichael James and the Pac-12 champion Ducks. The 2012 Rose Bowl game, Wisconsin, Oregon. Coverage begins January 2nd at 4:30 on ESPN.
Get the season to be ball!
I'll be damned.
Quand la neige recouvre la verte Finlande et que les rennes traversent la lande, le vent dans la nuit au troupeau parle encore de lui.
Quand la dans le ciel avec ton pinet rouge, le chariot du Père Noël. Quand ses frères le virent d'allure céleste suivre très digne les routes célestes, devant ses ébats plus d'un reine resta baba. Quand
l'appelait Nez Rouge. Ah, comme il était mignon, le tyrannosaure.